We want to start this on time. We only have 1 hour. Vice President Liu is already in her seat in Taipei, and I think we should start. I think you know the rules in terms of turning off all electronic devices. This is a video conference that brings in our Washington Council office as well as New York. We will have an opportunity after some opening statement by the Vice President and after she and I have a brief dialogue to have questions from the floor. This is on the record, and we do have journalists here. So I think we'll begin. Vice President Liu, I hope you can hear me. We welcome you warmly to the Council on Foreign Relations. 6 years ago, we had a similar video conference interview with President Chen Shui-bian. Last May, we were able to have an in-person interview with Mayor Ma Ying-jeou of Taipei. We wish we could have you here in person, but diplomatic rules seem to preclude that, right or wrong, but we're using technology to overcome diplomatic obstacles. We are concerned about the future of Taiwan, Taiwan-Mainland relations, U.S.-Taiwan-Mainland relations. Many of us still believe the so-called Taiwan problem is the most important problem facing American security, despite the tragedy of the Middle Eastern problems and despite our preoccupation with the North Korean nuclear crisis. Unfortunately, our media don't give us much information recently about Taiwan. You can look in vain day after day in our newspapers or watching TV for word of what's taking place, even when several hundred thousand people demonstrate outside the government headquarters. So this is part of an effort to bring more light about Taiwan and to help our people understand Taiwan's leadership and the various positions that leaders in Taiwan may take on very controversial questions. We know you've spoken here before. We look forward very much to your opening remarks. Thank you for coming.
Professor Cohen, distinguished guest of the Council on Foreign Relationships, good morning and greetings from Taiwan.
We need to hear you better.
I share my thoughts with all of you. Special thanks to Professor Cohen, my Harvard Law School advisor, for this wonderful opportunity, and to you for your interest in Taiwan's future. While some people may think about the presidential election in 2008, I would like to discuss with you where Taiwan is and where Taiwan is going. Right now, Taiwan is at a historical crossroads because of three challenges facing us. Number one, the rise of Taiwan's national identity. Two, the magnet effect of China. And three, the acceleration of globalization. First, after leaving the authoritarian past behind and embracing democracy at the end of the 20th century, Taiwan is developing a unique self-hold, what we call Taiwan 主体性, roughly translated as Taiwan nationality. A recent survey conducted by universities in Taiwan, Japan, and Hong Kong shows that 60% of people in Taiwan consider themselves Taiwanese, compared to only 18% in 1992. The result of the survey is not surprising. as more and more Taiwanese feel confident in Taiwan's achievement. At the same time, these and these young people share the China experiences that had previously defined a generation of Chinese on Taiwan. Taiwan's democracy has grown very fast, and we enjoy the same degree of freedom as other developed democracies like the United States. The 2006 Freedom House Survey gives Taiwan the highest scores in both civil liberties and political rights. At the same time, our democratic institution still suffers many legacies of the authoritarian era. Taiwan, as a young democracy, is experiencing what I call the symptoms of a transitional democracy. The alleged misuse of state affairs funds covered by the press is one example of such transitional crisis facing Taiwan. However, through this crisis, our judicial independence and fairness have improved. More importantly, our people now expect and demand more cleanliness and capability from politicians. Deeper institutional reforms are also needed to improve the transparency and effectiveness of our government. Thus, we must build our government based on the rule of law, and particularly on a sound constitution that is fitting for Taiwan in the 21st century. The second challenge for Taiwan is the magnetic effect of China. As China makes impressive economic growth, it has also developed different faces of power, described by Dr. David Dempson as guns, money, and ideas. The rise of China has an even greater impact on Taiwan than the rest of the world. The cultural ties and cross-distance result in greater cross-strait exchanges and economic integration. To date, Taiwanese businesses have invested in China 71% of our total foreign investment. 1 million Taiwanese people have settled in China. And transportation routes between Taiwan and China are some of the busiest ones. The Chinese government, however, has not given up the use of force against Taiwan. With 800 and 25 short and medium-range missiles deployed against Taiwan, China continues to increase its military capacity and projection of forces in space, air, and sea. China has stepped up the use of both intimidation and selection to undermine Taiwan in six different areas: military, economics, diplomacy, law, media, and psychology. China clearly recognizes Taiwan's strategic importance, as access to Taiwan is necessary for China to fully develop into a Pacific power. Today, new generations of Taiwanese are developing their own unique experiences of China, different from their elders. The leaders on both sides of the Taiwan Strait should define cross-strait relationships with new thought and new vision. Taiwan and China are relatives ethnically and close neighbors geographically. There's no reason to resent or to fight against each other. Constructive engagement and normalization of cross-strait relationships should be based on the three C's, namely cooperation, coexistence, and co-prosperity. Similarly, the international community should also re-examine the outdated and often misleading concept of the One China policy. Given the fact that Taiwan and China have been separate and independent from each other, only then can we find an effective solution to the cross-strait disputes. When we examine Taiwan's history, we find that the fate of Taiwan is not decided by China. Rather, it is tied to the affairs of the world. Looking from a Chinese perspective, one may see the inevitable merge of Taiwan and China. Looking from a global vantage point, however, one will realize that Taiwan does not belong to China. Rather, it belongs to the world. This brings me to my third and last point, the acceleration of globalization. Globalization has not only facilitated the rise of China, it has also increased Taiwan's significance to the world. In recent years, we have seen the completion of Taipei 101, the tallest building in the world, the Snow Mountain Tunnel, the longest road tunnel in East Asia, and the completion of the Taiwan High-Speed Railway. Taiwan's economic ranking continues to be among the highest in the world. In growth competitiveness, number 6. Global competitiveness, 13th. And economic freedom, 26. Taiwan's technological index is even more impressive, ranking 3rd globally. Taiwan's IT industry accounts for more than 60% of many major IT products in the world. And Taiwanese IT companies play an indispensable role in the global IT supply chain. That's why Business Week described Taiwan as an invisible powerhouse of the global economy in a cover story called Why Taiwan Matters. Despite the deliberate exclusion by China, Taiwan continues to engage the world. In the latest globalization index, Taiwan was ranked 12th in economic integration and 18th in technological connectivity. Taiwan is rising in a unique way. We have developed our own brand of soft power based on democracy, peace, love, human rights, and technological progress. In 2005, I founded the Democratic Pacific Union, an international organization of 28 democratic countries to promote democracy, peace, and prosperity in the Pacific region. Within 1 year, DPU has held conferences in 4 countries outside of Taiwan. Just last month, the DPU launched the Pacific Congressional Caucus with parliamentary members from 30 countries to promote democratic consolidation and better governance. Many people have expressed their expectation to see China become a responsible stakeholder. Don't forget that Taiwan has been a model of global responsibility in its compliance of international norms and in its contribution toward many humanitarian projects. It's time to recognize Taiwan's contribution, to respect Taiwan's national dignity, and to treat Taiwan as a responsible stakeholder. Why Taiwan matters? Taiwan matters because of its vital role in spreading democracy in East Asia. Taiwan matters because of its strategic importance to promote peace in the Pacific region. And Taiwan matters because of its indispensable position in the prosperity of global economy. What is Taiwan's future? Taiwan's future lies in the world, rather than in China. Taiwan has impressed the world, and the world shall embrace Taiwan. Thank you.
Vice President Liu, thank you for a strong opening statement. In the United States, occasionally politicians go from public office to prison. It's rare for them to go from prison to public office. Now in Taiwan, you went from prison 5 years to public office. You mentioned the authoritarian regime in which you grew up and originally acted. You say there are some traces of that authoritarian regime even today in democratic Taiwan. Could you tell us what those remaining traces are? To what extent does Taiwan politics, society, economy, etc., still suffer from the authoritarian heritage?
Well, Professor Cohen, I have been out of prison for 20 years, and I've been in president office for 6 years. However, we still suffer from the legacies of authoritarian era. For example, government employees are not well educated with the concept of human rights. We have to maintain, to educate, to remind the government employee how to respect and protect the human rights. And also, there are so many laws and regulations enacted during martial law regime. It takes time really to review and even to enact new laws and regulations.
What about constitutional reform? As you well know, the authorities in Beijing have a great fear of constitutional reform in Taiwan because they're worried that might lead to a formal recognition or declaration of independence. What is your idea about constitutional reform? What kinds of reforms do you have in mind?
Well, I would like to make a couple points. Number one, the contemporary constitution, the ROC constitution, was enacted in 1946, 5 years before Japan agreed to surrender their claim over Taiwan under San Francisco Peace Treaty. The ROC constitution was implemented in Taiwan for 40 years, however. We suffer a lot because that constitution was absolutely unsuitable for modern Taiwan. For instance, our system is neither a presidential system nor parliamentary one. The president is elected by the people. However, once he appointed premier, the executive power is vested upon the premier. The president can exercise only to the area of national defense and foreign affairs, making president very difficult really to govern the whole country. That's one example. China is so big a country, they have a number of level of government. However, Taiwan is very tiny, so too many level of government really create unnecessary inconvenience for our government to operate. For the betterment of a new government, we really need a new constitution. President Chen already made it clear, if ever we are going to have a new revision for the constitution, we are not going to deal with the most sensitive areas, including sovereignty, territory, and the question of unification versus independence. Therefore, there is no need to worry about anything toward the so-called independence. Taiwan has been independent with or without recognition. We already have the right to elect our national leader entitled president in 1996. So there's no reason to challenge the independent sovereignty of Taiwan. We would carry out our reform carefully and cautiously for the betterment of the governance and to consolidate democracy. Please trust that we will handle the issue carefully and responsibly.
Is talk of constitutional reform realistic at all, since Taiwan and its legislature seem so divided? How could you muster the necessary voting majority in order to enact constitutional reform of any kind?
According to the constitutional amendment adopted last year, it really a matter of pragmatics, very, very hard really to revise any single article of the Constitution. Constitutional amendment cannot become a bill until proposed by one-fourth of a total number of legislators and approved by a three-quarters majority of a quorum, and of at least three-fourths of total number of legislators. Furthermore, half a year after promulgation, the constitutional amendment proposed and approved by the legislature will be put to a referendum, which needs the consent of more than half of the Taiwanese citizens eligible to vote to pass. In other words, it really takes a long time before we can have a new constitution. Because the pace is so long and so difficult, we need to start as early as possible for the study, for the writing, and for the education. So please allow us to prepare for a new constitution for a better future. Not for the moment, but for the near future.
You have an election for the presidency coming up next year. You are one of the obvious candidates. If you run and if you should be elected, what specific policies would you pursue vis-a-vis mainland China? For example, would you try to establish the so-called three links of communication so we wouldn't have to have so much difficulty flying from the mainland to Taiwan? Would you take other specific measures? What could we look to you for in the way of new policies?
Well, I'm more than happy to respond to your question related to China. It has nothing to do with whether I'm going to run for president or not. Currently, I have been vice president for 6 years. I'm prepared to answer your question. The fact is that there's no problem of communication or correspondence between Taiwan and China. The only problem is the direct transportation. In fact, we already opened our policy with regard to a charter flight when a special vacation, like a New Year or Autumn Festival, for the convenience of overseas Taiwanese on mainland. The direct flight charter have been arranged. And for instance, we prepared to 48 flight to pick up the Taiwanese coming back for New Year this time. So there isn't much problem at all with that regard.
What about other forms of transportation and communication? Do you see any enhanced likelihood so that you can have people going from Kaohsiung by ship as well as by plane over to Shanghai or other leading Chinese ports?
Well, certainly we have to balance the interests between national security and the interest of the travelers. China being the only country which has hostility over Taiwan, the PRC authorities still refuse to declare to give up military strait over Taiwan, making Taiwan very difficult to allow direct unconditional flight from Taiwan to China or to China, from China to Taiwan. Can you imagine a flight directly from Washington, D.C. to Pyongyang? North Korea is hostile to U.S., have you ever seen a direct flight from North Korea to United States?
Some of us, of course, have advocated three links to North Korea also. But unfortunately, the current administration doesn't seem so disposed. What about your policies toward the United Nations, toward establishment of relations with the many countries and governments that no longer recognize the Republic of China as the government of China? What kinds of steps do you advocate there? I know you've been very active in promoting not only contacts among the governments that maintain relations with Taiwan, but also creating NGO organizational contacts throughout the Pacific and elsewhere in order to maximize Taiwan's relationships. But what do you think should be done beyond the current situation?
Well, being the one who started the UN bid for Taiwan, I am still convinced that sooner or later the United Nations would open the door to Taiwan. The fact is that Taiwan is the only nation on earth that has not been admitted into UN, not because we are not eligible, rather because, unfortunately, PRC boycotted it. If United Nations is really a United Nations international institution, they should have the door open to Taiwan as soon as possible. The fact that Taiwan has been isolated from United Nations does not mean that Taiwan would give up our intention to participate into international community. Thanks to United States support, that Taiwan has become a member of WTO in 2002. We work closely and actively with the members, other members of WTO to contribute. And we are working as hard as possible to become a member of WHO. And we have confidence that sooner or later, United States and many other countries will support Taiwan. Despite that, we already started an organization entitled Democratic Pacific Union 2 years ago, and we work very aggressively to share the development and experiences of Taiwan with the rest of the world, which I call soft power, soft diplomacy.
Are you open to new and creative ideas that might reach some useful compromise on Taiwan's representation in international organizations? Right now, you're seeking a stark up or down admission of Taiwan into the UN. But remember, the Soviet Union used to have several votes in the General Assembly. Would you be open to some kind of an arrangement whereby Taiwan was represented in the General Assembly, but as part of a greater China?
Well, I will remember that it took Korea 15 years to get admitted, both North and South Korea, into the United Nations. So I kept asking myself, if Korea could, why couldn't Taiwan? If China would allow both North and South Korea enter into United Nations, why China can allow Taiwan to be a part of the UN? Chinese leader Captain Hsiu-lien asked that Taiwanese and Chinese are sisters and brothers. If so, please show their sisterhood or brotherhood. Please embrace Taiwan into international community.
It's time now to allow our audiences in Washington and New York a chance to ask you questions and make brief comments. We're going to ask people here to wait for the microphone to come to you. Please stand and identify yourself in our usual fashion. Please ask only one concise question. The Vice President is doing an excellent job of giving us quick, responsive answers so we can maximize our discussion. And I want to ask people in Washington after one question here in New York. Anyone want to lead off? Carl Menzner. He needs a microphone. There it is.
Hello, Vice President Liu. My name is Carl Menzner. I'm a fellow here at the Council on Foreign Relations. I would just ask, if mainland China was to engage at some point in the future in a process of political liberalization akin to what Taiwan went through in the 1970s, what role might you see for Taiwan in that process, and what role might you see for Taiwan in a politically more liberal China in the future? Thank you.
The question is, what role might Taiwan play if China pursues a process of liberalization similar to the liberalization that Taiwan went through in the late 70s and 1980s?
Well, Taiwan suffered a lot from hegemony. I'm sorry, Taiwan suffered a lot from autocracy. Taiwanese people work very hard to overcome all the repression. So whenever China is ready to install democracy, Taiwan is ready to share with our experiences. For instance, one of the goals for Democratic Pacific Union is democracy. We're going to establish an institute for democracy. The electoral practice and regulation, for instance, we are very familiar with that, and we welcome the scholars and activities from China to come to Taiwan.
Jackie Miller in Washington, do you have any questioners there?
Yes,
Madam Vice President, Julia Chang Block, President of the U.S.-China Education Trust. All your life, you have been an advocate for women's rights. And last year, there was a time when you might have become president of Taiwan. I wonder whether you think Taiwan is ready for a woman president, for a female president. And if so, how would a woman president govern differently from a male president?
Well, as early as the year of 2000, Taiwan was ready who had the first of women to be elected as a vice president. 6 years has been passed. I'm sure that in the year of 2008, Taiwanese are ready to have any capable person, man or woman, to be elected as their new national leader. Taiwan is very open society. Being the founder of Women's Movement as early as 1970, I'm very proud to see the progress that women have made. And I thanks to my male colleague to support me for the liberation of women. It's time for the Taiwanese to make their decision if there will be a capable and charismatic woman to run for president, whether Taiwan will accept it or not. And perhaps there will be more than one female candidate.
Yes, we should take account of the fact Taiwan has a number of extremely able women in politics. And, of course, the vice president first came to public attention in the 1970s as a result of a series of articles she did in the press about the need for equal treatment for women. Another question here in New York. Yes, please.
Good morning, Madam Vice President.
I wonder if this microphone is, can you hear me? Because the other time you didn't hear, you can hear now, good. My name is Professor Benjamin Barber from the University of Maryland, and I had the privilege just 6 weeks ago of coming to Taiwan National University and delivering the Shi Ming Te lectures. Unfortunately, Shi Ming Te himself was not able to be there because, as you know, as one of the founders of the Democratic Progressive Party, who also spent 25 years in prison during some of the same time you were in prison. Can you hear? Yes. He has now self-incarcerated himself, put himself in voluntary jail of his own making in protest against corruption by President Chen. At least that's what he alleges. I wonder, in talking about human rights, I know you've stood forcefully for human rights, if you would like to comment on Shi Ming Te's protest against Mr. Chen, and also whether you think he should be a nominee for the Nobel Prize, which he is being presented for right now. I would like very much if you're able to make some comments both about his charges of corruption against Mr. Chen as somebody who was a former colleague of President Chen, but also about Shi Ming Te himself. Thank you.
Shi Ming Te, yeah.
Shi Ming Te and me used to be comrades to fight for human rights and justice. Before, when he demonstrated, he protested, he was arrested and was jailed for years. But when President Chen and me were elected into office, we try our best to protect fundamental human rights of each citizen. When he did the demonstration to protest against President Chen, we worked very hard not to infringe upon his right to assembly and to protest. We try our best to protect him. We bless him the best, even today.
I take it you're not nominating him for the Nobel Prize.
Well, if I were a member of the nominating committee, I could answer this question. Unfortunately, I'm not a member of the committee, so I would rather make no comment.
Liz Economy?
Madam Vice President, thank you so much for taking the time out to speak with us. My name is Elizabeth Economy. I'm a senior fellow here at the Council on Foreign Relations. You mentioned in your remarks the security of Taiwan and the challenge that the mainland poses to the security. One of the issues over the past 6 years in the U.S. relationship with Taiwan has clearly been this issue of the defense of Taiwan, the issue of the armed purchases agreement that has yet to make its way through the Taiwanese legislature. Could you talk a little bit about how you see Taiwan's commitment to its own defense and what it needs perhaps to change in order to protect itself more effectively in the future?
In the year of 2000, for the first time ever, Taiwan had a transfer of government and power. Unfortunately, for those who lost their power, for those who used to be in power for decades, of sudden they lost their power, they couldn't adjust it. So they tried to boycott all the bills presented in the Congress, including military budget. President Chen and me and the Premier worked very hard to see that national defense budget can be passed as quick as possible. Unfortunately, in the past years, we failed. We still expect, because in this couple of days, the Congress is having their final days of this session. We have reason to expect that opposition members of Congress under the command of Chairman Mao, Ma Ying-jeou would give a support because national security is a matter bipartisan. So we sincerely hope that Professor Cohen might do something to convince Chairman Ma Ying-jeou to give the national security a support. Thank you.
I'll do my best. What about questions in Washington? Jackie, you have another question down there?
Yeah, we do. Richard?
Madam Vice President, it's Richard Bush of the Brookings Institution. It's nice to see you again, and I'm glad to see you haven't lost. Glad to see you haven't lost your sense of humor.
Thank you.
Taiwan will have two important elections within the next 14 months, both for the legislative yuan and for the president. I wonder if you could make a prediction. What will be the DPP's major campaign theme for these elections, and what do you predict will be the Kuomintang's major campaign theme for these elections?
Well, I'm not a fortune teller. I cannot predict. This time will be most difficult because we're going to have a totally new system for our congressional election. So all the candidates are not that confident. However, we try to have the rule again as fair as possible. So we'll wait and see. And even the decision regarding whether we should have a congressional election and presidential election to be implemented together is a debate. Some are in favor of having two into one to save money and also for a better reform of election. However, there are some other people who would rather to hold these two elections separately. So everything is open for discussion. It will take perhaps 1 or 2 months before the decision is made. Maybe after that I can have a better prediction.
Thank you.
Yes, Herbert Levin.
Madam Vice President, thank you for your presentation. You have pointed out that Taiwan's investment in the mainland is usually top, and that many Taiwanese have chosen to move to the mainland and live there for extended periods. We read in the newspaper of the Buddhist ties and the Mazu ties, religious ties building up, and you have it has been suggested that the Li Fa Yuan doesn't vote money for more arms purchases. They don't seem to be afraid of an attack on Taiwan. Kuomintang leaders have been to the mainland for discussion. It seems that everybody in Taiwan wants to work out a peaceful relationship with the mainland, which is not easy, but the DPP is rather stagnant. Do you think the DPP is likely to become more flexible in the future on this question?
Well, China and Taiwan's economical linkage is extraordinarily close. China now is Taiwan's number one export destination, the largest source of Taiwan's trade surplus. Taiwan's investment in China occupied 71% of total foreign investment last year. So I don't think it's fair to criticize that DPP's government is closed door policy.
When you say 70,
from 1991 to November 2006, the total amount of Taiwan's business investment in China is $53.6 billion. And the travelers is up to 423 million, and we have over 1 million Taiwanese settled in China already. However, because the Chinese authority still refuse to give up their military threat over Taiwan, making Taiwan's national security number one concern of the country. We have to take care of the security of the citizen and the country. We have to help maintain the stability of this region. Unless China openly give up their military threat over Taiwan, unless China respect the sovereignty of Taiwan, we have to have our policy reserved to some degree. However, Taiwanese people enjoy their freedom to travel, to invest, to do business in China and to the rest of the world.
Other questions in New York? Yes, in the back, please.
Thank you, Professor Hassan. Madam Vice President, this is Peter Wei from the Epoch Times. My question is, since about 2 years ago, the publication of the Nine Commentary on the Communist Party by the Epoch Times, there have been 18 million Chinese people who associated with the Chinese Communist Party or the Chinese Youth League announced their withdrawal. There are more people coming to join. So what do you think this would mean for the future of Taiwan and the people in China and the cross-strait relationship? Thank you.
As I addressed earlier in my opening remark, I propose three C's for a normalization between Taiwan and China, namely peaceful coexistence, cooperation, and co-prosperity. We welcome the development economically and politically of mainland China. And it's only democracy is installed in China that peace and stability in this region can be assured. Let's walk closer toward that goal.
Have you personally been to China mainland?
Yes. In 1990, I was invited by Overseas Taiwanese Association from China to visit China. They kindly entertained me for 1 month. By then, I was nobody. But the next year, I was allowed to run for the Congress and got elected. Based on my experiences of 1990, I tried to develop the relationship between Taiwan and China, but failed because when I started to promote UN bid for Taiwan, my name was blacklisted, and ever since then, I was not allowed to visit China anymore. I certainly expect that the door will open again, not only for me, but also for President Chen. President Chen, ever since he took office, reiterated his goodwill to start a new relationship with China. Any kind of dialogue, any kind of meeting is welcome.
What about Washington? Any questions down there?
Yes, Tom.
Madam Vice President, Tom Williams with the Department of the Navy. Throughout 2006, there were several initiatives to promote maritime security cooperation between the Pacific Command and mainland China. Could you speak to the political implications on Taiwan to those efforts?
Despite the distance between Taiwan and China is so close, unfortunately, the direct transportation at sea is still not available because China is not ready to negotiate with us for the business. And number two, in the past years, so frequently we see pirate activities. We see smuggling of drugs and crimes and female prostitutes. That's why we really urge a direct official meeting with Chinese authority for all these matters related to the well-being of people on both sides.
But what is your reaction to U.S. military naval cooperation with China in joint exercises and similar activities? Do you favor closer contacts between the U.S. military establishment and the mainland, or do you think that's a bad idea?
Any method of modernization and liberation of military is welcome, is comfortable for the stability of this region. We also expect that the military relationships between Washington DC and Taipei can also be increased. In the recent years, we are happy to see that a considerable high ranking of our military officials are allowed to attend military meeting with U.S. military officials. But if a certain kind of military competence mechanism can be built, not only in between Washington DC and Taipei, but in between Taipei and Beijing, that would be a very good message for the peace in this area.
New York questions? Yes, Nick Platt.
Nick Platt, President Emeritus, Asia Society. I'd like to ask a question about future generations, Madam Vice President. When I was in Taiwan last year, I had a number of conversations with younger politicians from both parties. One of the consensus attitudes that I found was the ideal for the next generation. They all said, what we want are three things: an American education, a job in the mainland, and a home in Taiwan. Could you comment on that and whether that concept is something that you are fully aware of in the people who are going to succeed you?
A job in the United States?
A job in the mainland.
I understand. Yeah, a job in the United States.
No, a job in China.
Taiwan. Oh, education in America, a job in mainland China, and a home in Taiwan. How about a wife from where? Well, I'm glad to
where?
Hear about that. That sounds that the university is going to be accomplished. Based on my philosophy of soft power, including human rights, democracy, peace, love, and technological progress, is perhaps not a dream that people and people can work together across the border of territory to achieve that common goal. If one can have good education in the United States, why can't he have such education in Taiwan and in the rest of the world as well? So in the trend of globalization, we shall also concern about the equal opportunity, the equal development on the earth. I would suggest that attention should be paid more to the underdeveloped countries, to the poor family, and to the minority people.
How about Washington questions?
Does anyone have? We don't have anything right now, but check back.
New York? Yes, Maggie Lewis, NYU.
Hi, Maggie Lewis from NYU. As a young China scholar, I, like many people in my age group, studied in the mainland, although I have recently spent time in Taiwan, and it was an honor to meet you when I was there. But I'm seeing a decreasing number of people who are studying in Taiwan as they become China scholars. And I was wondering, what is the Taiwanese government doing to encourage academic and cultural ties with the U.S. and other countries?
Okay. Well, academic exchange certainly is the best access for the university. Economic education is a platform for exchange of values, thinking, and culture. Our government always welcome the good student, the best scholar to come to Taiwan. In fact, our Ministry of Education have a considerable amount of grant open for application of those who are interested in studying in Taiwan. The DPU, Democratic Pacific Union, founded 2 years ago, also offer 50 fellowships and another 50 scholarships to study in Taiwan. To conclude, we really respect knowledge and we concern a lot, and we are ready to support those who are interested in economic exchange. Please come to Taiwan.
Well, I hope you will do more in that regard, but I also hope, as you know, your government will do more to let people in the outer world understand how much progress Taiwan has made with respect to rule of law development. In the 60s and 70s, we used to listen to this nonsense from the Chiang Kai-shek government about how Taiwan represented free China, when it wasn't free at all, of course, as you experienced. But I'd like to see your government do more along those lines so the rest of us would know about recent accomplishments. Yes? You need a mic. Yeah.
Nicholas Bratt, Lazard. Madam Vice President, in view of the nuclear developments in North Korea, how tempted are you to develop some nuclear capability of your own for protective reasons?
With the advanced technology, Taiwan is capable to develop nuclear. However, Taiwanese people are most peace-loving people on Earth. From government point of view, from people's point of view, in fact, we never have any idea to develop nuclear because our philosophy is constructive, not destructive.
What about corruption? You have a very serious corruption problem, not really in your judiciary or in your prosecutor's office, as we've recently seen, they're quite independent. But in your legislature, in your local elections, your political system seems to be still shot full of corruption. And we thought the DPP might be more successful than it appears to have been in rooting out corruption. What policies do you favor?
Well, Taiwan is a young, emerging democracy. We are not perfect. We are not mature yet. We make mistakes, and we try to learn and grow from the mistakes. There are a limited number of politicians who made mistakes in recent months. They have been condemned, and our judicial power has exercised in a very impartial way. And we expect the judicial independence and fairness can prove that our democracy has been consolidated. As I made remark earlier, that because of this corruption crisis, people learn and people expect from our politicians more cleanness and more capability. That's the price we pay, and also the nation that our democracy then trusts Taiwan, because Taiwanese people pay a remarkable price to achieve democracy. We cherish, and we are not going to let democracy spoiled.
Last question, Herb Levin.
Madam Vice President, in the U.S. there's been considerable favorable publicity for the reopening of the Gugunbo Guan in Weishuangxi, and that 1,000 visas will be given to tourists from the mainland. I wonder whether Taiwan will be changing its policy to allow tourism from the mainland and even allow investment, in other words, something like China's policy toward Taiwan. Thank you.
Yes. Our government is ready to welcome more tourists from mainland China to Taiwan. But up to today, we haven't achieved an official agreement with China authority for the matters related, because it takes a big job really to take good care of all the travelers to Taiwan. In the past, there are some tourists who come to Taiwan but illegally, so making some traffic problems and also crimes. So we welcome an official direct discussion and an agreement to be entered into. And we are prepared to welcome Chinese tourists to come.
I want to thank you, Vice President Liu, for an excellent presentation. I think all of us have a better feel for your current views, and we see you also as a person. We like your sense of humor, and we hope you will soon be able to come here in person in whatever capacity you might enjoy in the future. Thanks very much for helping us out.
Thank you, Professor Cohen. I will remember in the year of 1985, while I have difficulty to get out of the country, you helped me a lot. Would you please help me again? Ever since I took office, I was told that from now on, it's too sensitive for you to visit our country, making me another kind of prisoner. Perhaps I would like to take this opportunity to urge all the esteemed guests who attended this meeting to help President Chen and me and all high-ranking officials from Taiwan to have the honor to visit Washington, D.C. It's a pity because Taiwan and the United States are so close to each other. However, the high-ranking officials are not allowed to see and to discuss issues related in person. I really would like to take this opportunity to urge a review of this policy. Thank you.
Well, as you know, a favorite song in the mainland in Taiwan is "Tomorrow Will Be Even Better." Thank you very much.
Thank you.